So welcome to this second session of the day, which is going to be about dependent types and rewriting. Before I announce our first speaker, I would like to remind you that you have two ways of posing questions, either through the Q&A option or by raising your hand. The questions will then, you know, you will have to wait until the end of the talk, but you can pose your question at any time, or you can raise your hand in the middle of the talk. And then if you still want to ask your question in the end and you haven't lowered your hand, then I will allow for the question to be made. So now we are going to have our first talk by Frédéric Blanqui, which is going to be about type safety of rewrite rules in dependent types. You can start.
Well, thank you very much, and hello everyone. By type safety, I mean what is also known as subject reduction. So let me first explain to you or remind to you, I mean, what is subject reduction in two different contexts. So first, in typed programming languages, it means that if you have a language with some operational semantics described by this arrow here, and you have a typed language, so some program T of type A, and then so T evaluate to some value U, then the value that you get at the end has the same type. Okay. And so it's very important. So in programming languages, it is used to ensure memory safety. It means that if you have a program computing some string, for instance, then in the end, you will get a string and not a float. And so the same property, but in logical system, is also important. But in this context, what we are talking about is proofs and propositions. So if you have a proof T of some proposition A, and T is simplified to some other proof U, then U is still a proof of A, okay? So it expresses the correctness of cut elimination, but it has also other applications, for instance, to prove the correctness of type inference, independent type theories, and so on. So now I'm going to speak about a particular system using dependent types that is called the deductee. So deductee is a kind of purely functional programming language because it is based on the lambda calculus. But of course, it's not a language like C or Java. You don't have input outputs and these kind of things, but you can define a lot of functions in such a system. And so what is particular to this language is you have two important features. The first one is that you have dependent types. So it means that types can take values as arguments. And then you can define your functions on even your types using rewrite rules. Okay. And so this system deductee implements what is also known as the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. So let's see a very simple examples of some piece of code you can have in deductee. So here, the first line, you declare the type n of natural numbers with the constructors zero and successor. And then you define, you declare another function symbol f, but the output is a type using this keyword. And then you define this function f. So if it's a zero, then you return the type n itself. And if it's a successor of some natural number x, then you build some euro type. So for instance, using this function, you can express the euro type n euro n euro n as f of 2. And these two expressions are so identified in the system. So let's see the kind of rewrite rules you can use in deductee. So in contrast to languages like OCaml or Coq, You can have overlapping left-hand sides. So like here, for instance, the addition on the natural numbers, you have both the induction on the by induction on the first argument, but also on the second argument. So it's symmetric. You can also have pattern matching on defined symbols here. So the addition to express associativity of addition. And you can have non-linear left-hand side, like here, for instance, in group theory. And also higher-order pattern matching. So I'm not going to enter the details here. And just after, after this talk, there will be another talk by Gabriel Rondet about the implementation of matching for this kind of rewrite systems. So what are the applications of deductive? It is used as a logical framework to express theories and proofs of many logical systems like Hall-Light, Koch, and PVS, and so on. And another of my PhD students, Guillaume Genestier, will explain just after how to translate AGDA programs, AGDA proofs, into deductive. So also then it can be used as an independent proof checker for these systems, and also as a tool to transform proofs from, to code proof transformations. And especially for translating a proof coming from one system to another one. So now let me explain so what is the problem we want to solve. So proving the subject reduction property, so making sure that when you apply a rewrite rule in the context of deductive, so the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting, indeed, so rewriting will preserve typing. So first, I'm going to recall the language that we use in deductive. So as I said, so it's based on the lambda calculus. So you can find the standard term constructors for the lambda calculus. So here you have constants for your function symbols, but also your type symbols. You have variables, the lambda abstraction that comes with a type annotation, and then the application of the lambda calculus. So in addition, in deductive, so you have, in order to represent types, you have two new constructions. So first, sorts, and you have only two sorts, the one kind, type for types, and kind, which is used for some technical reason. I'm not going to detail now. And then you have what we call the pi type, so the dependent product of A and B. And what is different from the usual euro type of a simply type lambda calculus is that now in B, you may have occurrences of X. Okay, this is what we call a dependent type, that the output may depend on the input. And then for typing these terms, you have, as usual, typing environments where you declare the type of each variable. And then rewrite rules that are just so application of a function symbol to some arguments and rewrite to some term. So what is specific, you can see here, is that because we have dependent types, so terms and types are defined simultaneously. So now let's see the typing rules of the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. So first, as usual, you have the rules for checking that the type declarations of variables are valid. And then for each term constructor, you have a typing rule. So here for function symbols, for variables, and then for abstraction and application. And so you can see for the abstraction that the type is a dependent type. It means that so in B, you may have occurrences of the input X. And then as a consequence, in the application rule, when you apply term T with some dependent type to a term U with the same domain, then what you get, so T applied to U, is B, where you replace X by U. And so finally, you have new rules, in contrast to the simply typed lambda calculus, you have new rules for these new term constructors, so sorts. So you, here you can see that kind is the type for the sort type. And then you have a rule to make sure that a dependent type is well formed. And finally, because the types may depend on values, then it means that if you have a term T of some type A, and A is equivalent using so the beta reduction of lambda calculus and the rules declared by the user. So if A is equivalent to B using all these rules, then T is also of type B. Okay, so one important property of the system is then you can check that the type of a term is not unique, but unique up to the transitive closure of this joinability relation. So it means that modulo the equational theory for beta and the rewrite rules, types are identified. So now, what is the property I want to check is that when you apply a rewrite rule, you preserve the typing. So it means that for all typing environment, gamma, for all substitution sigma, for all possible type C, if so the sigma instance of L is of type C in gamma, then also the sigma instance of the right-hand side has the same type in the same environment. And so usually, so for instance, in simple type theory, this property is not very difficult to check, but it becomes undecidable in the case of a lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. So how to prove this property? So the first, but we are going to see not so good idea, is to do like we do, for instance, in a simply type context, is to ask, well, to ask that the left-hand side has some type B, and then that the right-hand side also has the same type B. But as we are going to see just after in some example, this condition is very strong, and it enforces many rules to be non-linear in order for the left-hand side to be typeable. And this, as a consequence, makes rewriting less efficient and confluence much more difficult, if not possible, to prove. So we will try to avoid to have non-linearities in rules. So let's see on some simple examples. I will reuse in the following. So here we define the type of vectors of some given dimension. So you have two constructors, nil for a vector of size zero, and the cons, which add an element to a vector of size n to get a vector of size n plus one. And then we want to define the tail function using this rule. So if tail is applied to a cons argument, then we just return the last argument of the cons. But as you can see, so this rule, which is a very natural, is not typeable because so the argument cons xpv, if you look at the type of cons, okay, is a vector of size successor of p. But tail n waits, I mean, is expecting as argument a vector of size successor of n. And p and n are two different variables. So these two types are different. Okay. So one solution is, of course, to replace p by n, but then you get a non-linear rule. Yet, it's possible to check that, in fact, this rule preserves typing, because if instead of looking at the terms themselves of a rule, we look at instances. So if you take a typeable instance of the left-hand side, what can we say? Then all the subterms are typeable. So n, if we look at the type declaration, so we get that n must be of type n, x of type a, p of type n, and so on. And so v must be of type, must be a vector of size p. But all these things must be a vector of size successor of n. So we get that by inverting the typing rules that these two types must be equivalent, in fact, by uniqueness of types. And then we can check that so v, the right-hand side, that should be so of type vector of size p. But here, using confluence, because v and s are undefined, we get that p and n are equivalent. So like this, we can check that indeed the rule is preserving typing. And so this is what I would like to automate this kind of reasoning. So this is my contribution in this paper. So how to do this? Then there are several steps. So the first one is to compute the equations that must be satisfied for the left-hand side to be typeable, say by some fresh constant C. And the goal is then to prove that the right-hand side has the same type modulo these equations. The problem is how to type check that a term is typeable modulo some equations. So currently there is no such tool, but what we can do is instead turn the equations into a convergent rewrite system using the famous Knud-Mendix completion procedure. And then so we get an equivalent rewrite system. And then we can try to check that the right-hand side has the type of the left-hand side in a system extended by these additional rules that represent so the typing constraints of the left-hand side. So now I'm going to give some more details about each step. So first step, so we try to compute the typeability constraints of the left-hand side. So it goes like this. So there is one input, that is the term we want to type, and two outputs. First, the type, and then some set of equations that we accumulate. So at the beginning for a variable, then the type is the type of a variable that we represent by this new constant, the variable with a hat. And there is no equation in this case. But when we apply a function symbol to some with this type, with some arguments here, so we can try to infer the type of each argument. So we get types A1 and AN with some equations. And then we can say that f applied to t1, tn is typeable, and the output is u, where we replace, because it's a dependent type, x1 by t1 and xn by tn. Okay, so that's why we have this sigma application here. And for the equations that must be satisfied, we have the previous equations for each argument. But also we have new equations because we must make sure that indeed T1, which is of type A1, is a valid argument for the first argument of F, which should be of type T1. Okay, so we get this new equation like this and so on. So we can iterate this. And so if we take the example of a tail function, you see that we get something very similar to what we did by hand just before. So we have all these equations that, so the type of n is the natural numbers, the type of x must be equal to a, and so on. And we get this equation that the vector of size p plus 1 must be equal to the type of vectors of size n plus 1. So this is the first step. And so the second step is to turn this the set of equations that we get into a rewrite system. So here I summarize in the example, so the equations that we get. And here you can see that we have in fact a set of closed equations because we consider all these variables as constants. They represent some terms. So we can use any well-founded order that is total on closed terms. So like for instance, the lexicographic path ordering. And then, so in this case, the Knuth-Bendix completion procedure terminates always. And so we can here easily, so taking for instance, this order on constants, get this set of rules that is orienting so the equations from left to right. So then the last step is to check that the right-hand side has the same type as the left-hand side, modulo these rewrite rules. So if we take our example, what do we get? So we have to check that the right-hand side, V, is of type, the type of the left-hand side, which is V of size N, modulo, so these rules that we have computed using Knuth-Bendix completion. So V, the type is vector of size P, and we have to prove that it's equivalent to a vector of size N. But with these rules, there is no rule we can apply. So we have two normal forms that are not equivalent. Okay, so there is something missing. We see that here, this rule is about vector successor of P reduces to vector size successor of n, but this is not what we would like. We would like to have vn and vp equivalent. So here you see that we need some additional intermediate step between the first and the second step. Once we get the equations and before computing the rewrite system using Knuth-Bendix completion, we need to simplify the equations using confluence of the rewrite relation. So because, so here we have this equation that Vsp is equal to Vsn, but V and S are undefined symbols. So in fact, this equation is equivalent to the simpler equation P is equal to N. And so if we do this, so we repeat Knuth-Bendix completion, and then we get this rewrite system here. And then we can conclude that indeed the right-hand side has the same type as the left-hand side. So to summarize, the main contribution of the paper is a procedure to prove that a rewrite rule preserves a typing in the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. So there are four steps. The first one is to compute equations that must be satisfied for the left-hand side to be typable. Then we simplify the equation, so using the confluence property of rewriting and beta reduction. The third step is to turn these equations into a convergent rewrite system using Knuth-Bendix completion. And finally, we check that the right-hand side has the same type as the left-hand side in the system extended with these additional rules. So in order to do this verification, we need to make sure that this system has good properties. So in order to prove that it is decidable, we need to check that it terminates and it's confluent. And so in the paper, you will also find a termination criteria for the combination of so beta reduction and rewriting with a closed a set of closed rules that is terminating. And so this is the end of my talk. I thank you very much. If you have questions.
Thank you, Frédéric. Are there any questions? You can raise your hand if you have questions. So there are questions. Let me see. The Femke is asking, is it easy to see that the equations in call E of step one are well typed?
So are the equations are well typed? So it's a good question. So we could apply recursively, I mean, the same procedure to make sure that these equations or the rewrite rules that we get are indeed typable.
And we have a question about, do you have Church Rossum? Do you have, I think that you talked about that, about confluence.
Yeah, so here I assume that we have a confluence property. It's important not only for this, but for other properties. So for instance, just for proving that beta reduction itself preserves typing, you already need a confluence. You know? So it's complicated because there are many dependencies between various properties in type theory. So for instance, for between confluence and subject reduction, and also to prove termination. And so this is something I talk about in the workshop on confluence, how to be able to prove all these properties, even if there are important dependencies between them.
So we have another question. Are there examples of rewrite rules for which your procedure cannot show subject reduction, by Michael Farber?
Well, probably. I mean, it's not. This is an undecidable problem, and the procedure is not complete. So it's yes. I mean, it's possible to build examples. But I mean, in practice, this is an improvement in contrast to the previous procedures that was implemented in deductee. So we are very happy with that, but perhaps we could even improve later. Is
okay. Any more questions? Okay, so thank you, Frédéric.